from his holy hill. We kneel for confession. Deliver us, O Lord, from all our sin, and restore us by your promise. We confess to you, O Lord, that we have sinned against you in thought, word, and deed, by the evils we have done, and by the good we have not done. We have rejected your word, as you have sent it to us, to call us to repentance, and have refused your mercy. Deliver us from our hardness of heart. Forgive us for the sake of your Son, Jesus Christ, our Lord. Restore us by your grace, that we may walk according to your word, and delight in you in our inmost heart. Amen. Almighty God, in his mercy, has given his Son to die for you, and for his sake forgives you all your sins. As a called and ordained servant of Christ and by his authority, I therefore forgive you all your sins, in the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit.
Amen.
Please stand. Salvation belongs to the Lord. Your blessing be on your people. But you, O Lord, are a shield about me, my glory and the lifter of my head. I cry aloud to the Lord, and he answered me from his holy hill. I lay down and slept. I woke again, for the Lord sustained me. I will not be afraid of many thousands of people who have set themselves against me all around. Glory be to the Father, and to the Son, and to the Holy Spirit, as it was in the beginning, is now, and will be forever. Amen. Salvation belongs to the Lord.
Your blessing be on your people.
Rivers in the desert, to give drink to my chosen people, This is the word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
Then the owner of the vineyard said, "What shall I do? I will send my men on the sun. perhaps they will respect him. When the tenants saw him, they said to themselves, "This is the heir. Let us kill him so that the inheritance may be ours." They threw him out of the vineyard and killed him. What then will the owners of the vineyard do to them? He will come and destroy those tenants and give the vineyard to others. When they heard this, they said, "Surely not." But he looked directly at them and said, "What then is this that is written? The stone that the builders rejected has become the cornerstone. Everyone who falls on that stone will be broken to pieces. When it falls on anyone, it will crush him." The scribes and the chief priests sought to lay hands on him at that very hour, for they perceived that he had told this parable against them, but they feared the people. So they watched him and sent spies who pretended to be sincere that they might catch him in something he said, so as to deliver him up to the authority and jurisdiction of the God. This is the gospel of the Lord.
Praise to you, Lord Christ.
Please be seated. Easter egg there, right? What is it? Hitchcock's in all this film, somewhere. He might be a silhouette somewhere or a passenger coming out of the bus. You watch that film closely enough, you're going to see him. And to this day, we just saw a movie not too long ago where a guy sitting on a beach greets the hero of the story, and it turns out that guy is the voice who plays the hero in the video game version of the movie. So it can be anything. It might be simply looking at your watch, and people who are in the know what's going on, and people who aren't, they don't really lose anything by it, but they don't really gain much either. In our gospel today, there is an Easter egg. And I'll tell you what it is, but first we need to know the story and understand the story, and we'll understand what's going on there well enough. Then we'll get to the Easter egg. So the story is something that the people who Jesus told the story to understood very well. They knew from their Old Testaments that when God talked about vineyards, vineyard keepers, vines, and so on, he was talking about his relationship with his people, with Israel. So the vineyard keeper is God, the tenants to whom he lends out or seeks to take care of the vineyard are the religious and political leaders of Israel, and the people whom the owner sends to collect fruit are the prophets who seek the obedience and faith of the children of Israel, and so often do not find them there. Instead, they find unbelief and unrepentance. And in fact, even worse than that, the tenants beat the servants. They send them away empty-handed. In one version of this, Jesus says they kill some of these. But finally, the vineyard keeper, or the owner, says, I will send my son. That's one of the first ones I call. This one they will listen to, because it is as if I myself were there. They, the tenants, look at it just the wrong way. They know very well who the son is. And they say, because he's the son, let's kill him, and then we get everything. Now, especially Jesus' enemies knew that he was talking about them, but everybody got the picture. After all, they say, surely not, this can't be the case. Especially when Jesus says the owner is going to kill, he's going to destroy the wicked tenants and give the vineyard to others. So we know what this is all about. Jesus has enemies. They're going to do exactly what the parable says is going to do. They're going to kill the son, the one who is the heir, and in fulfillment of that, way down the road, and about 40 years later, God will destroy the city of Jerusalem, and the gospel will scatter around the world. So we know the story. We know its fulfillment in the death and resurrection of Jesus. And we know that this very story is the thing that brings us salvation, forgiveness of sins, and life, eternal life to us. That's the story we'll be focusing in on next Sunday, Passion Sunday, and of course, Maundy Thursday, Good Friday, and Easter. That's all about. So you're kind of seeing it in preview form in this parable that Jesus tells. Now here comes the Easter egg. It is Jesus' quote there. If you are looking at your gospel or bulletin, it's the part that's in italics. Jesus says, the stone that the builders rejected has become the cornerstone. And he goes on to say about that cornerstone, everyone who falls on it will be broken to pieces, and when it falls on anyone, it will crush him. Now, if you're not in the know, that can seem kind of strange. But we're in the know. We know that what Jesus is doing here is quoting Psalm 118. If that rings a bell, it's because for sure you know some of the verses in this psalm. Right? It begins, O give thanks unto the Lord for, and his, there's the newer translation, steadfast love endures forever. That's how we get a little messed up. We all have different translations. How about this one? Well, you've heard this and maybe not quote. It is better to trust in the Lord than to trust in man. It is better to take refuge in the Lord than to trust in princes. Ring anything else? And I think we quote that often enough, especially when our this one. The Lord is my strength and my song. He has become my salvation. Now that shows up in some of the songs we say, some of the hymns. The Lord has become my salvation. That's pretty fantastic. How about this one? This is the day that the Lord has made. What comes next?
I will rejoice and be glad.
Yes, yes. Let us rejoice and be glad. That's all in this same psalm that Jesus is quoting. And when he quotes it, he expects you who understand the Easter egg to have all of that in mind, everything that we just quoted. How about this one? Blessed is he who
comes
in the name of the Lord, which is used on Palm Sunday as Jesus enters the city. So we realize he is the one who comes in the name of the Lord. He's the Messiah who brings salvation. And then, very often, in Holy Communion, before we take the sacrament, we say those very words because we recognize the body and blood of Jesus are here to give us the same salvation that he comes to give us on Palm Sunday. He is the one who is blessed in the name of the Lord. So all of that in mind, I want to focus on that one phrase, this is the day that the Lord has made, let us rejoice and be glad. Now, I don't know about you, but wake up in the morning, the sun is out, and the birds are chirping, and it's just going to be a fine morning. That verse just pops into my head. I have to admit, it doesn't pop into my head all that often. When it's snowing outside, if it's blustery or raining, it's a little harder to say that. But what I want to do today is make it so that you can say this phrase anytime and recognize it. So you put all of that stuff into the hopper from Psalm 118 and realize that Jesus is talking really about this week in history, right? This time when he is going to go to his death and his glorious resurrection. And we start to think, this is the day that the Lord has made. What is the day that the Lord has made? It's actually that particular day, Good Friday. The Lord made that day, and he made it a special day. He made it a special day because that is the day that the Creator of heaven and earth died on a cross for you and for me. And we are to rejoice and be glad in that day because it's because that day is the day that wins salvation. That's when the victory becomes ours. When Jesus Christ, by dying, defeats death. And because he has done that, other days will be special days too. For instance, 3 days after, when he rises from the dead. That's a day that the Lord has made. Let us rejoice and be glad in it too. It's so special that in the early church, they referred to that as the eighth day. Right? So you have the days of creation, the Sabbath day of the Lord, and the next day, a brand new day, a never-ending day, the eighth day, the day of eternity. That's how they saw that. And they saw every Sunday as being that kind of day. Okay, so now we reclaim not only Easter Day and Good Friday, but we've got every Sunday, or at least one seventh of the week through, where we can say, this is the day that the Lord has made, let us rejoice and be glad. Got another day for you. How about the day you were baptized? That was the day you were incorporated into Jesus Christ. That was the day you participated in his dying and in his rising. That's what St. Paul writes in Romans chapter 6. We were buried with him by baptism into Christ, that just as he was raised from the dead with the glory of the Father, even so we should walk in newness of life. We have a new life, an eternal day, because we have been baptized into Christ. And you can celebrate the anniversaries of that. So now we've got a lot of the days coming, haven't we? All of a sudden, it's the day of your baptism tomorrow. How about this? Every day is now a day that we can say this because Jesus Christ has done these things. So this Easter egg that he has sent to us is really a way of proclaiming salvation to us. He, whom the builders rejected, that is, the religious leaders, the political leaders of his time, many of his own people, he is the most important stone, the cornerstone, the thing upon which everything is built. Every day you're being a Christian church, you and I are the body of Christ. And then, we acknowledge this, we confess this, we rejoice this, and then we release it. Everyone who falls on that stone will be broken to pieces. And when it falls on anyone, it will crush him. That doesn't sound particularly good, does it? I neither want to be broken to pieces, nor do I want to be crushed. But I guess, if those are the choices, which one do you go off for? I'm going to go for broken to pieces. Right? If I'm broken to pieces when I'm confronted with my sin, and my pride, and my selfishness, and my ego, my anger, my whatever it is, my disrespect for others, my neglect of God and the things of God. And I'm broken to pieces, and I need to be broken to pieces. Because that way God can pick me up and put me back together. In fact, when you're broken to pieces, you're dead. And God raises the dead. So if you aren't dead, how can God raise you? So I'm making the case that if you want to be falling to pieces and tripping over this stone all the time, you see, that's the way in which we come to Christ. You fall over the stone and you pick yourself up on your knees. That's why on our knees we confess our sins to God our Father. We receive absolution on our knees. And then we can stand and appear before the Lord because He has taken the broken pieces and He's put them back together the way He wants them to be. The other option, well, you heard it. When it falls on anyone, it will crush it. And the confession that comes to my mind is that passage in Revelation that says, in those days, they will say to the rocks, fall on us, and to the mountains, cover us. You're going to want to be destroyed that way because of the wrath of the Lord God in His fury and in His justice and His righteousness. So there's a warning and a promise in this cornerstone. Either way, it tells you that Jesus is saying to us, He is the deal. He is what it's all about. You either trust Him or you don't. You either have life or you have death. You will either be with Him in eternity or you will be isolated in hell. That's the whole story right there, including the Easter egg. So we should take it for what it is. We ought not to join the scribes and the chief priests who seek to lay hands on Jesus and destroy Him. That is to cover up His message, to get it out of the public eye. But instead, we need to be bold in our confession. And we need to say, Christ is my cornerstone. And we need to be glad for it and rejoice in it, so that all may see that salvation is ours through Jesus. That way, the Easter egg, it's also an Easter egg, a thing that celebrates the resurrection of the Lord Jesus, a thing that acknowledges all that He has done for us. So God grants you that boldness, that confession, and I dare say it, God grant that you may be broken into pieces so that you may not be crushed. Amen. And the peace of God which passes all understanding will keep our hearts and our minds in Christ Jesus. Amen. We turn to page 12 in our bulletins and continue singing Living Stones on the middle of the page. Please stand.
Thank you. maker of heaven and earth, and of all things visible and invisible, and in one Lord Jesus Christ,
the only begotten Son of God, begotten of His Father before all worlds, God of God, light of light, very God of very God, begotten not made, being of one substance with the Father, by whom all things were made, who for us men and for our salvation came down from heaven, and was incarnate by the Holy Spirit from the Virgin Mary, and was made man, and was crucified also for us under Pontius Pilate. He suffered and was buried, and the third day he rose again according to the Scriptures, and ascended to heaven, and sat at the right hand of the Father. He will come again in glory to judge both the living and the dead, whose kingdom will have no end. And I believe in the Holy Spirit, the Lord and giver of life, who proceeds from the Father and the Son, who with the Father and the Son together is worshipped and glorified, who spoke by the prophets. And I believe in one holy Christian apostolic church. I acknowledge one baptism for the remission of sins, and I look for the resurrection of the dead, the life of the world to come.
Amen.
Let us pray. O Lord, deliver us and turn us from our pride to hold fast to the surpassing worth of Christ Jesus and His righteousness for us. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer. O Lord, preserve your church, strengthen the preaching of your word and the administration of your sacraments, as your people receive these gifts with penitence and faith. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer. O Lord, cause our civil authorities to discourage evil and encourage good. Keep us mindful that our hope is in you. Help refugees from the war in Ukraine and grant peace to that land. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer. Lord, bestow your kindness on all in any need, especially Raymond as he recovers from surgery, John Thomas and his wife Deb, you and Nancy, Kathy, Sydney, Marilyn, Tom, George and Bonnie, Sharon, Don, Renee, Missy, Dan, Lily, Dee, Inez, Bernadette, and Emily. Lord, in your mercy,
hear our prayer.
Lord, give us repentant hearts, that we would abandon all confidence in our flesh. Receive your Son's body and blood for the forgiveness of our sins. Lord, in your mercy,
hear our prayer.
Lord, in baptism, you have shared Christ's suffering, death, and resurrection with us, that we might be raised from the dead. Encourage us to forget what lies behind and strain forward to what lies ahead until we attain the resurrection from the dead. In the same Jesus Christ, the Son, our Lord, lives and reigns with you and the Holy Spirit, one God, now and forever.
Amen. Amen.
The service of the sacrament is on page 13 of our bulletin. The Lord be with you.
And also with you.
Lift up your hearts.
We lift them to the Lord.
Let us give thanks to the Lord our God.
It is right to give Him thanks and praise.
It is truly good, right, and salutary that we should at all times and in all places give thanks to you, Holy Lord, Almighty Father, everlasting God, through Jesus Christ our Lord, who overcame the assaults of the devil and gave his life as a ransom for many, that with blessed hearts we might be prepared joyfully to celebrate the Paschal feast in sincerity and truth. Therefore, with angels and archangels and with all company in heaven, we laud and magnify your glorious day, and for more praising you have to say.
Thank you.
Blessed are you, Lord of heaven and earth, for you have had mercy on those whom you created and sent your only begotten Son into our flesh to bear our sin and be our Savior. With repentance and joy, we receive the salvation accomplished for us by the all-availing sacrifice of his body and his blood on the cross. Gathered in the name and remembrance of Jesus, we beg you, O Lord, to forgive, renew, and strengthen us with your word and spirit. Grant us faithfully to eat his body and drink his blood, as he bids us do in his own testament. Gather us together, we pray, from the ends of the earth, to celebrate with all the faithful the marriage feast of the Lamb and his kingdom, which has no end. Graciously receive our prayers, deliver and preserve us. To you alone, Father, be all glory, honor, and worship of the Son and the Holy Spirit, one God, now and forever.
Amen.
Lord, remember us in your kingdom, teach us to pray.
Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory, forever and ever. Amen.
Our Lord Jesus Christ, on the night when he was betrayed, took bread. And when he had given thanks, he broke it and gave it to the disciples and said, "Take, eat. This is my body, which is given for you. This do in remembrance of me." In the same way also, he took the cup after supper. And when he had given thanks, he gave it to them, saying, "Drink it, all of you. This cup is the New Testament in my blood, which is shed for you for the forgiveness of sins. This do as often as you drink in remembrance of me." The peace of the Lord be with you always.
Amen.
Thank you.
Let us pray. We give thanks to you, Almighty God, that you have refreshed us through this salutary gift. And we implore you that of your mercy you would strengthen us through the same, in faith toward you and in fervent love toward one another. Jesus Christ, your Son, our Lord, who lives and reigns with you and the Holy Spirit, one God, now and forever.
Amen.
The Lord bless you and keep you. The Lord make his face shine upon you and be gracious to you. The Lord look upon you with favor and give you peace. Amen. We turn to page 15 in our closing song, I Offer My Vow. Still time to get across the street.